On June 1, 1926, Gladys Baker Mortensen welcomed her first and only daughter, Norma Jean. Her birth certificate says her father was Edward Mortensen. However, Gladys nor Norma never really knew who the real father was.
I never lived with my mother. My mother's first husband was named Baker. Her second husband was Mortensen, but she was long since divorced when I was born. She had, you know, mental disturbances, and she was taken away.
She'd come over one day, and for no reason that I know of, she just broke in the glass on our front door. And I believe we called the police, didn't we? Something happened.
After Gladys took Norma back, she was diagnosed with schizophrenia. Norma Jean was then put under the legal care of her mother's best friend, Grace McKee. Grace was about to get married and could not take care of Norma. She was then put in an orphanage.
Grace used to come to the orphanage and take me out sometimes. Well, she was my legal guardian, and she once worked as a film editor, and she had been my mother's best friend. I could put on her lipstick. I was only 9 or 10, and she would take me someplace to have my hair curled, which was unheard of because I had straight hair. Things like that meant a great deal to me.
Fall in love, it will be.
I just felt like I was on the outside of the world, and suddenly when I was 11, everything opened up. Kids in school. Well, it's true, mostly they were boys, but even the girls paid a little attention to you just because they thought, she used to be dealt with. For instance, I had this long walk to school, 2.5 miles to school, 2.5 miles back. Then I'll tell you, it was just sheer pleasure. Every fellow honked his horn, and I'd wave back. I thought, gee, what happened? The world became friendly. It opened up to me. The newspaper boys used to come around to where I lived, and here I was, 11 and 12, hanging from the limb of the tree. And then some of them would bring a friend along, and they'd all pull their bicycles up around the tree, and I would ask the boys, I said, can I ride your bicycle now? And they said, sure. And then I'd go zooming, riding down the block, laughing, riding, and they'd all stand around and wait till I came back.
When Norma was 15, Grace and her husband Doc had to move and could not take Norma with them. They gave her an ultimatum: either stay in the orphanage or marry their neighbor, James Doherty. She chose marriage. On June 19, 1942, Norma and James got married. In the spring of 1944, James joined the Merchant Marines.
Love is ended before it's begun.
Basically, I had to ship out. And when I ship out, she moved in with my mother, and my mother worked at Radio Plane. And she got Norma Jean a job over there working in what they call the dope room. That's where they put the whatever kind of stuff, they put it on the fabric to harden it, like a glue, I guess, to harden the fabric. They put it on these little airplanes.
You turn the heat on me, some like it hot.
We were at the factory. Mm-hmm. David Conover came to the factory to take publicity pictures for the Army of the girls working in the American factories, so the soldiers would know about it. And he come across Norma Jean, and the camera loved Norma Jean, so he kept photographing her, and then he built a portfolio for her.
From those photographs, she was taken to a modeling agency, the Blue Book Agency, and she really was very popular as a model. She modeled at the Roosevelt Hotel in swimsuits and all over the place. And then Ben Lyon, who was a casting director at 20th Century Fox, he discovered her and put her under contract.
The agents at 20th Century Fox did not believe that Norma Jean was an appropriate name for such a woman like her. Marilyn had always liked the name Monroe, and they believed that she looked like the actress Marilyn Miller. They put the two ideas together and created the name Marilyn Monroe. They also asked her to bleach her hair, creating a woman who would soon become the sex icon of the century.
And then I get letters all the time, and then later, after several trips, the letters were not quite as often, and I talked to her, and she was, I found a script, and she said she was going to make a movie, or going to be tested for a movie, and I kept telling her, well, you know, hon, this is fine, I'm glad you're enjoying it, but when I get out now, we're going to start a family, we're going to be normal people, and she agreed to that. And she knew this is what I wanted, so one day I was sitting in the Yangtze River waiting to go into Shanghai, and a mail come aboard, and there's a Dear John. And it was sent by her attorney from Las Vegas that she wanted a divorce.
There is a river called the River of No Return.
And then I was dropped, and then I was hired at Columbia for 6 months under stock contract, you know, where you have options. They put me in a movie called Ladies of the Chorus. Oh, it's terrible. And terribly photographed. Oh, everything was awful about it. So they dropped me after 6 months.
After being dropped and left out of work, Marilyn desperately needed money. When help was offered, Marilyn made a decision that would change her career and the life of men forever.
So, Tom Kelly had asked me, I had done some beer ads for him, and he had asked me to pose nude. But I always said, no, I don't do nudes, never. And then I got so far behind the rent, 4 weeks, and I was in debt and everything. So I called up and I said, are you sure they won't recognize me? He said, I promise.
While at Columbia Pictures, Marilyn met Johnny Hyde. He helped Marilyn turn things around. Hyde landed her two roles in the movies The Asphalt Jungle and All About Eve. He also helped her negotiate a 7-year contract with 20th Century Fox.
I had the market send over some salt mackerel for you. I know how you love it for breakfast.
Some sweet kid. It's late. Why don't you go to bed?
Sometimes wild and free, love's a
In 1953, Marilyn was photographed for the first time in Life magazine. That year, she was also casted with Jane Russell in the movie Gentlemen Prefer Blondes.
And it is Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Because they always kept saying, remember, you're not a star. I says, well, whatever I am, I'm the blonde. You notice in Hollywood, where millions and billions of dollars have been made, there aren't really any kind of monuments or museums. You know, and I don't know, I don't call the Grauman's Chinese, putting your
footprints in the... All right, there's kind of a sentimental value to all that. And it meant a lot to me at the time, for my own personal reasons. But nobody left anything behind. They took it, they grabbed it.
I wanna be loved by you, just you, nobody.
If you will, remind me the first time you ever saw Marilyn.
It may very well have been Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. My guess is that it probably was.
Oh, thank you ever so.
May I kiss your hand?
I always say a kiss on the hand might feel very good, but a diamond tiara lasts forever.
When you saw her, do you remember the impression she made on you?
Well, I loved her right away. Yes, I think she is iconic and defines Hollywood glamour.
In the 1950s, men mostly worked blue-collar jobs. This meant skilled or unskilled manual labor. It included manufacturing, mining, construction, technical maintenance, and other types of physical work. Women were expected to be stay-at-home moms and wear ponytails and poodle skirts. In 1953, magazine publisher Hugh Hefner decided to publish a magazine to help the blue-collar men. He wanted to create a lifestyle magazine for single working men. It would tell them what to wear, current events in society, and entertaining articles. Hefner soon realized that he had to add a sex appeal to attract more buyers. The main purpose of this magazine was to break the mold that society was creating.
Sex always will be an important part of the book, because sex is probably the single thing that...
Hefner saw the nude calendar photos of Marilyn and wanted to make her the first centerfold.
So I drove out on North Avenue in my beat-up 1940 Chevy and convinced him that it would be good publicity. And he sold me the right to reproduce the nude image for $500. I got a very good bargain.
And she was a playmate, right? It wasn't called
a playmate.
She was
the very first.
She was the very first, but it was called something else then.
Sweetheart of the Month.
Sweetheart of the Month.
I want to be loved by you alone.
Their marriage took place in January of 1954, but was destined to last less than a year. From the day they took off for their honeymoon in Japan, the couple's every public move was captured on film. Marilyn had no problem with the camera, that was her business. But DiMaggio was basically a shy, private person who disliked media intrusions. His baseball career had endowed him with a charisma he didn't want. And now he found himself escort to a woman who could draw a crowd in any city in the world, a circumstance he wasn't comfortable with.
DiMaggio was not happy about her performing. In fact, he didn't like her lifestyle at all. He didn't like how provocative she dressed and would often insult her. He also didn't like her role as a sex symbol. He felt as if it took away from her role as a wife. In 1954, Marilyn was filming one of her most memorable movies, The 7-Year Itch. This movie includes Marilyn's iconic skirt-blowing scene. DiMaggio was the only person who did not like this movie. At the end of filming this scene, DiMaggio got violent with Marilyn over his disapproval. This ultimately ended their marriage.
Our marriage wasn't a happy one. It ended in 9 months, unfortunately.
Right here, fella. Watch it, Sidney.
All I can say as her attorney is that this is what we would say with the conflict of careers.
What can we ask her about it? No.
Were you going to
give
me the right this morning, Marilyn? What's the picture?
McFarlane.
What picture are you working on now?
We're going
to see. Let's make sure. Who's going to work it, babe? Gary, you're going to work on the phone.
After the divorce, Marilyn starred in three of her top films, Bus Stop, Prince and the Showgirl, and Some Like It Hot.
Need me to think you could care. You didn't need me, you had your share of slaves around you to hound you and swear with deep emotion, devotion. And to feel the desire to make you my own.
The unique couple was always in the public eye, and when the Red Scare broke, there was no escaping it. Many entertainers, like writers and actors, were accused of McCarthyism by HUAC, the House Un-American Activities Committee. When given the chance, suspects could be freed by naming other suspicious communists. However, Miller did not take this opportunity. Francis Walter, chairman of HUAC, proposed a deal with Miller. If Miller agreed to let his wife pose for Walter's campaign poster, he would be set free. Unfortunately, Miller refused. He was convicted and sent to Washington. At his hearing, Marilyn spoke in favor of her husband. Her words had a tremendous impact on Miller's appeal.
We want to see Mr. Clement. We're from the Let's Make Love Company. It's very important. What's the matter with her? Did I say something?
During the filming of her movie, Let's Make Love, Marilyn's health started to weaken. She claimed some of her depression was due to Miller's unwillingness to help. And to make matters worse, it is said that Miller became interested in German photographer Inga Marith. He met Inga on the set of his movie, The Misfits, which Marilyn Monroe also starred in.
And you and Marilyn were divorced when?
About 61.
And you married Inga a year later?
Yeah, but, yeah.
Swept on forever. To be lost in the storm.
After several weeks in the psychiatric clinic, Marilyn was allowed one phone call. She chose to call her ex-husband, Joe DiMaggio. He immediately demanded that she be moved to Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, and she was then discharged a month later. On May 19, 1962, Marilyn Monroe was asked to sing Happy Birthday for the United States President, John F. Kennedy.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Mr. President. Happy birthday to you.
Enjoy your swim?
I always used to take a moonlight swim on the island.
With Adam?
Adam?
Did you always take a moonlight swim on the island with Adam, Eve? Oh. Adam and Eve.
Under her contract with Fox Studios for the film, Monroe was being paid to film for 35 days. However, Monroe only appeared for 12 days, and the film was never finished. She was then sued for $500,000 by Fox Studios for breach of her contract.
This was our idea of how Monroe's last unfinished film, a bedroom comedy called Something's Got to Give, might have opened had it ever reached the screen. It didn't, because Monroe was fired after 8 weeks of filming, here on stage 14 at 20th Century Fox. She was sacked for what the studio described as spectacular absenteeism, and it was hinted for drifting through her scenes in a depressed and drug-induced haze.
Take me. Oh, leave me, I'll never be perfect, believe me. Call it a curse, or just call me blessed. If you can't handle my words, you ain't getting my best. Is this how Marilyn Monroe fell? Must be how Marilyn Monroe fell. Is this how Marilyn Monroe fell?
It's been almost 50 years since the world's tragic loss of Marilyn Monroe. However, her legacy continues to impact the lives of people everywhere today. Her life lives on as actresses portray her in movies and TV shows use her life as a storyline.
tropical heat wave.
Michelle Williams was nominated for an Oscar for her brilliant portrayal of Marilyn in My Week with Marilyn. The actress acknowledged the challenge of portraying the icon.
In a way, you sort of had to remove the fact that she was an icon and put that out of your mind because it would be too daunting, and instead try and think of her as a girl, as an ordinary girl, which is really how she wanted to be thought of ultimately.
Shall I be her?
Marilyn.
Steven Spielberg created an entire TV show about two starlets clamoring to play Marilyn on Broadway.
I think it's genius to tap into the plot lines of her life and parallel them into storylines in Smash. You know, each character kind of mirrors some aspect of her life, so it really behooves all of us to do our research.
She has such a drive and such a love for what she does, and I think that's where I relate most with her, just sort of that just relentless nature of just being determined to do what you do and not taking no for an answer, and that I really relate with.
Hugh Hefner never actually met Marilyn Monroe. However, he loved her as if he had, so much that he hopes that she will be close to him even after his death.
She is buried in a vault just a few blocks from here,
right,
in the Westwood Cemetery, and I have the vault right next to her.
You do have it. How did that come to be?
I bought it. When I learned it was available, I thought, you know, there's something natural about that. So Marilyn and I will be spending the rest of eternity side by side.
And I want to say that if I am a star, the people made me a star. There was no studio and no person, but the people did. There was a reaction that came in to the studio. I mean, fan mail, you can't imagine.
This is how Marilyn Monroe.